And to your left.
I'm a watchdog.
She's
very good. This
is you, Nydia.
This is very good in
Tisdale.
You're busy out, otherwise I'd shake your hand. Thank you so much for coming.
Excuse me?
Yeah, I think I'll say, okay.
Agenda, they are down here on the front level. Good morning. I'm going to go ahead and call the meeting to order. I have 9:15 on November 16, 2012, and I'm going to dispense with my opening comments and reserve to make comments before we adjudicate the motion for fees, to recover fees in connection to the Governor Deal investigations. I do have some comments I want to make before we take those up.
I think we're going to take a break. We're going to adjourn and let's reconvene. And I've got 10 after 11. My watch is a little fast, so let's maybe 20 after 11. Be a 10 to 15 minute break. Stand adjourned. Yeah, I'm sorry, Hillary. We'll call you back. All right.
Okay.
William, just clarify for me that he will speak beforehand, but if I'm going to speak on your behalf, I need to do it with the I tried to get that by him, and he said, well, unless he's being back, I said, well, he was for 19 years the executive before him. He's obvious. I said, well, I want to
ask him this
to
be earlier.
You ask him, or I'll ask him anyway.
I'm on the definition.
She wrote that down for me real quick, and I can read it off.
I have about 11:25, and then I'm going to go ahead and call us back to order. Okay. Next item on the agenda is we have four pending motions to recover attorney's fees connected to the Nathan Deal investigations. It's the chair's understanding, first of all, the procedural matter, that Mr. Anderson has actually withdrawn his motion to recuse and motion for counterclaim. So the motion that was filed yesterday for fees connected to those motions, assuming that Mr. Anderson has continued to take position, those are withdrawn, won't be necessary for adjudication. I said at the beginning of the meeting that the chair was going to reserve comments for this portion of the agenda, and I am going to comment now. For those who have been here from the beginning, you've heard a lot of discussion about how the commission is charged as an executive agency for enforcing Georgia's Government and Campaign Finance Act. There is a specific section, OCGA 21-5-6-23, that specifically authorizes this commission to assess fees against a complainant when that complaint is deemed frivolous or without legal merit. So, while we encourage the productive and careful oversight of government, be on guard, be on notice that frivolous complaints that are filed without merit or are filed in a political context to gain political advantage, you can be assessed fees for all of the work that goes in to adjudicating those complaints. And let me tell you, it's a lot of work. Our agency spent almost 2 years investigating the Governor Deal complaints. There were hundreds, if not thousands, of pages of documents. Everybody who was sitting up here spent an inordinate amount of time trying to figure out what the complaints were about and how best to adjudicate them. The commissioner to my right, Ken Alexander, is the general counsel for CARE. He spent an entire weekend leading up to the hearing working on this. I know because I was on the phone with him, talking about what was being alleged and how we were going to best adjudicate it. And everybody knows we ultimately administered a $3,000 administrative fee, and I'm very proud of that conclusion. But the commissioner to my left, Commissioner Garrett, he also worked a lot on figuring out what was going on with the Governor Deal investigation, as did Vice Chair Stringfellow. And I know the Vice Chair worked throughout the weekend because I spoke with her too. And we were all trying to make sure that we understood the issues and the merit and got to the right place and the right conclusion. So again, let me be clear. We have the statutory authority to assess fees for frivolous complaints. Be on guard. With that, I have told Mr. Perry from Common Cause I would recognize him before we adjudicate the three now pending motions to recover fees connected to the Governor Deal investigation.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Again, I'm William Perry, Executive Director of Common Cause, Georgia. Just a few points to make in general, but obviously because this is the first time this issue has come before the commission, I think it's our first test. So I did want to say that from the very beginning, our organization has been opposed to this method, to the awarding of attorney's fees for a frivolous complaint, because we predicted and have actually experienced the chilling effect that this has as public policy. Your decision today is extremely important because it could scare the life out of folks who are thinking that they would receive the same result if they brought forth a legitimate complaint. And our office has received two calls from people who have active complaints pending saying, is there somebody that can help me if this happens to me? And that has happened as a result of this case in particular coming out to the public. Secondly, in just trying to interpret the laws that I guess you just talked about, Joe, spent a lot of time looking at, it's extremely tough. And let me just say that we stand against the fee assessment, but we do recognize that there is a need to handle and discourage frivolous complaints. So I don't want in any way to say or be interpreted as saying that frivolous complaints are okay, because they're not. But the way this could handle and the amount of money that could be levied against someone is something that could create fear and a legitimate complaint by a legitimate citizen. Secondly, we often talk about, and everyone often talks about, exasperation, your lack of rulemaking authority. And as I looked at the code and this ability for you all to award the attorney's fees in case of a frivolous case, there was no definition of frivolous in the code section. So I have to wonder, do you have the ability to determine what is frivolous if you can't have the power to interpret rule or set rules? So I don't know if you can make an award based on something being frivolous if you can't define or say what frivolous is. And then I think finally for my specific remarks, and I want it to be clear that I am not, and my organization, Common Cause Georgia, is not specifically defending the complaints that Mr. Anderson put forward. I think much of the complaints, the wording and such, were not something that I agree with, that our organization agreed with, and I think were, in fact, improper. But
I think the based on the fact that the points brought up or the arguments that were being made took so much work by the commission, was started and completed with an investigation by the staff, makes it not frivolous, because so much time and effort and interpretation had to be put into it. How can it be the definition of frivolous if it was something that was so considered and took so many steps? I think, you know, if anything, I would argue that some of the words in the presentation of the actual complaint were libelous. That is a charge that would be fair to say, but that's not something this commission has the authority to consider. So I would argue in that case that this is not a frivolous complaint, because while the wording can be seen as even malicious, that the issues that those complaints brought forward were legitimate. And I'll give you, outside the commission's purview, something that y'all perhaps don't have the authority to rule on. But again, I don't think that that makes it frivolous. That just gives you the ability to say we couldn't rule on this. And just a final thought, and then I ask the chairman's permission to allow one of my board members to come up and speak to more specifics legally, and he'll take 2 to 3 minutes to do that. But my final thought is that, you know, earlier y'all decided to reduce fees to $25 for people that, you know, had the hardships or because of just some certain process. But I think in this case, if you even reduce these attorney's fees that you'll award to $25 or even $5, we're making a very dangerous public policy statement to citizens that you can be fined. And so this time, it might just be even $5, whatever y'all would decide or award. But no matter what the amount is, making that step sets a precedence that I think will strike fear in many people's hearts that would have legitimate complaints. So I thank you for the time.
Thank you, Mr. Perry. I don't know what more your board member could really add to that, but if you would like to be
very
recognized,
brief.
Okay.
Very brief.
Thank you.
And I'll talk as I'm coming up short of time. Let me thank all of you first for your public service, and I will note your volunteer public service, which we appreciate very much. Just 2 or 3 points I want to make very briefly. On the suppressive effect that Mr. Perry just alluded to, the statutory scheme here, 21-5-2, notes the terribly important public interest of a full disclosure of private interest that may affect the discharge of public duty. In that regard, I would just ask you to remember something that I think pertinent from a long time ago in history. At Socrates' trial, he noted to the jury that if you kill a man like me, you injure yourself more than you do me. The process can be injured far more than even one individual could be who had a proceeding like this against him. 2 or 3 other very quick points, and I'll take a minute or two. First, I would ask you to consider the fact, because I know you're all very public spirited, you wouldn't be on this if you were not. The process stands to be damaged here by this fact. When you look at the code section, the subsection 23 that you alluded to, Mr. Chairman, what is problematic about that is what is quite possibly an unconstitutional delegation to an executive agency of judicial powers. And what you notice here is that when you look at the civil penalties that you can impose, the 1,000, 10,000, 25,000, those have limits. But this provision is unlimited. So in reality, an executive agency could impose $1 million of liability on someone, which is a judicial function. I would ask you to consider that as you look at this, because it's not limited like the civil penalties are. And I would suggest that might need to be examined by your staff attorney as a possible violation of separation of powers. Second, the unconstitutional vagueness. Frivolous is not defined. You all are not given anything to go on by the statute. You know, most other attorney's fees provisions have very clear definitions and guidelines. What have you? You're left altogether too much on your own. I would submit to you that's not fair to you or the process, as well as to the people who are specifically involved. Lastly, I would ask you and your counsel to look at the possibility of an unconstitutional denial of due process and equal protection under both the 5th and 14th Amendments of the Federal Constitution and the comparable provisions of Georgia Constitution to this end. when you look at that same code section, it strikes me that it provides, and presumably this would have to do with any, if you imposed a attorney fee award here, and that had to go to court in order to enforce that, which seems to be the statutory scheme here. It's interesting it provides that the Superior Court shall enforce the orders of the Commission and the civil penalties assessed under this chapter, and the Superior Court shall not make any independent inquiry as to whether the violations have occurred. That would seem to be very different from under the Administrative Procedure Act, where you get judicial review, because it ties the hands of the courts and would leave them as little more than, with all due respect, as just rubber stamps of what's already occurred by an executive agency. So that seems to be a very disparate treatment under equal protection and due process from all other people who might have awards being imposed against them by administrative agencies. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Appreciate the comments. And
of course.
Right. The chair notes this is an area of first impression of Georgia law. No question about it. There are no constitutional attacks that I'm aware of that would impede us from going forward today and adjudicating the issue. But I appreciate the points, and we're gonna move forward. So the first motion to recover fees is connected to matter of respondent Nathan Deal, case number 2011-08. I see Mr. Evans here.
Excuse me, Chairman. You had one other gentleman from Common Cause.
Oh, sure.
Mr. Chairman, a point. This gentleman's not from Common Cause. Not speaking on behalf of Common Cause Georgia or for Common Cause, so I just wanted to clarify that.
Okay.
I am, in fact, the former executive director of Common Cause.
Okay.
And I wanted to maybe speak not so much to the substance vision.
And sir, thank you for, if you could keep your comments to less than 5 minutes, we certainly
absolutely
we've got a lot to cover.
I understand.
Okay.
I can do that. My name is Bill Bozarth. I have a lot of history with matters before the Ethics Commission. I was a member of the Board of Common Cause Georgia back in the 1990s. That's when I first heard of George Anderson, the bookseller from Rome, who was filing lots of matters before the commission. In 2001, when I was still on the board of Common Cause, my predecessor brought forth the idea of awarding George Anderson some award for us. He was one of those people that qualified for what we call citizens awards. We try to recognize people who actually go into activist mode and on their own and try to make the system work better. And when we were debating that, we knew, so he's a quirky guy. You know, he's not your average person. He is unique in this state, and he has filed over the years so many complaints of different types. I got to know George after I became the executive director in 2002. I would say to you that as part of that relationship, he and I visited a lot of places way out in rural parts of Georgia. Many matters that don't come before a body like this actually come up as matters of public officials potentially misusing their office across the state. Those are issues that George has addressed not only at the state level, but at local levels over many years. He tried to make a living out of that. He recognized that this was a passion in his life, and he really believed that holding public officials accountable is something that is a worthy thing to do, and he's done that. But as a process, he suffered a lot. He had to close his business. The bookstore closed a number of years ago. And I'll tell you some things about George that he probably wouldn't say about himself. His financial situation, like so many people in Georgia, is very tenuous right now, as his health. I think he's not nearly the advocate he was 15 years ago when he first came on the scene. And that is something that I think you want to take into consideration. Do we really want, at this stage of the process, to take this man who has obviously provided some things into the system that I would agree have been nitpicking and not necessarily so serious? But he's also filed complaints which eventually led to some rather significant criminal prosecutions in either the federal court or by the Attorney General. Those include complaints against Bill Campbell, the mayor of Atlanta, Linda Shrinko, the former school superintendent, and Charles Walker, who at one time was the majority leader in the Senate. All of those people have been convicted of very significant wrongdoings in public office. I know over the years that when George would come to me and he would say he had something that he wanted to bring forth, I would counsel him. I said, George, you've got to make a distinction between the big deal and the little deal. And frankly, George has trouble doing that, in my opinion. However, that does not diminish the value that he has brought in being one of the few citizens outside of a political opponent that will actually bring something forward. And I think that's why this commission was put in place in the Ethics and Government Act, so that ordinary citizens could, in fact, bring these matters before you. I would say that this is not a court of law. It is, in fact, a quasi-judicial body, and I don't believe you should impose the same standard on the complainant that you would in a normal code of law, and I think that's what's being done here. The last comment I would have is a political one. I'm sort of at a loss as to why the governor, having gotten what he wanted from the commission in terms of being able to move on against all these complaints, which were essentially dismissed or handled in some way, would want to go the extra mile to try to really leave the impression that he's willing to come down hard on the person who complained against him. And I think that's something this commission needs to keep in mind, too. What are the political implications, really, of taking a system that was put in place for the ordinary citizens to bring complaints and have a draconian effect on the...
And
complaint.
I don't want to interrupt you, but the governor did pay over a $3,000 administrative fine.
Yes. Okay. Yes. My point is, all of that has been settled, Mr. Chairman. Right. It would be appropriate to move on and not make further issue of it. I think that would be the thing I would ask to consider. So.
Thank you.
In a sense, I appreciate you hearing my remarks, and I hope that you can adjudicate this fairly today.
Thank you. Thank you for your time and comments. We're going to go ahead and move forward on. I mean, I see that there's somebody else that wants to make a comment, but we've got a lot of ground to cover. I'll have public comment at the end of the meeting, but we've got motions that are pending, and we're going to go ahead and move forward at this time. Mr. Evans. I see he is here on behalf of Governor Deal. If at all possible, if you can address all three of your motions in one set of remarks, we would be grateful. And I have indicated to Mr. Anderson that each side would have 25 minutes. I'm betting you don't need 25 minutes, but you are welcome to take your allotted time, and Mr. Anderson will do the same. Yes. Let's wait for you. We'll come back if we have. Okay.
No.
All right. We will take a recess till 1 o'clock and reconvene that.
Thank you,
Hillary.
Have
And the question is, where would that line be? I don't think I will spend a lot of time on the idea that somehow award of attorney's fees provisions are unconstitutional or illegal or improperly chilled, given that we know that under Rule 11 of the Federal Rules, 915.14 of the Georgia Code, 566 of the Court of Appeals Rules, Rule 6 and 7 of the Supreme Court Rules, Georgia Court of Appeals Rule 15, all have virtually the same provision. None of them define the term frivolous, because the recognition is that you can decide what frivolity is. Now, we don't have a whole lot of problem with frivolity here, because between the finding of the staff, the finding of the commission, and even the commentary of third parties, we all know that the statements made crossed over the line and were in fact frivolous. And the truth of the matter is that even quirky people have to live by the rules. Federal judges, when they're assessing the imposition of Rule 11, don't sit around and decide when pro se's file frivolous materials that, oh, that we somehow can excuse that because they were either pro se, infirm, or had a bad day. The rules apply, and the question is, when those rules apply, what is the appropriate remedy? I want to address one other legal issue, and then I want to get to the heart of what this motion is about. There was the suggestion that somehow our motion pursuant to 2156B23 was subject to the anti-SLAPP statute. And there's a Supreme Court, or Court of Appeals, or Supreme Court of Georgia specifically ruled that the anti-SLAPP statute is inapplicable to a motion for attorney's fees under the statute. That is the Earth Resources LLC versus Morgan County case, 281 Georgia 396. I just wanted to take that. It is an illustration of how absolutely legally frivolous the arguments that are made to you are. But here you have an argument that is repeated oft in every single filing for which there is a case directly on point. Now, it isn't as if Mr. Anderson is new to this idea of citing cases or otherwise arguing the law. In fact, the State Bar of Georgia itself found it necessary that when he would not follow their bar rules, that they took the courageous step and, in fact, filed a lawsuit against him to stop the unauthorized practice of law. And so the idea that somehow, you know, we should be reticent or tepid or timid about enforcing the rules is belied by the fact that federal courts, the State Bar, and others have all said there is indeed a line and we have to enforce the line. Now, I want to talk about what we're here for. We did not file a motion for recovery of the fees for the claims that were dismissed. So all of the claims that the commission heard, which involved 4-1 decisions in some cases, unanimous decisions in other cases, all of those decisions are not what's before you. We did not file a motion for anything to do with the conduct of Nathan Deal. The governor actually decided that being part of the political process is a rough and tumble business and you have to have a thick skin. And so none of the motions relate to anything to do with him. None of the motions relate to any case that actually made its way in terms of any kind of investigative procedure or resources. Because, again, the goal here is to narrowly zero in on where is the line. The motion before you relates to three specific complaints that involved people other than the governor. It involved his daughter-in-law, it involved my law firm, and it involved a chairman of this commission. And so I want you to take note. All of those were administratively dismissed as without any basis in fact or law. Frivolity having effectively been determined. And as a result, I don't want you to think that in any way this is designed to address the general process of the Ethics Commission. It is designed to address what happens when you have a complainant who makes malicious, false, personal attacks on people who aren't even a part of the process, who are not candidates. And I zero in on one. The attacks that were made, for example, against the governor's daughter-in-law relate to her operation as a fundraiser. And the sole basis of the allegation is that they are related. Now, I want you to think about the implications of that for every candidate. Everybody talks about chill. Well, what's happening is you chill good candidates. Because the very fact is that what happens is once you become a candidate, every member of your family becomes a target. And they become a target for the most frivolous and malicious allegations possible. And as Mr. Perry pointed out, these aren't just malicious and frivolous, they are libelous. And the things that were written, the statements that were made, were so far over the line that it compels some response or some action to be taken. The suggestion that I took kickbacks or that I kicked back fees. Indeed, you know, I wish big law firms worked where we had some kind of discretion over anything whatsoever, but that's not the real world. And every document, every public filing made such an allegation absolutely ridiculous. Now, unfortunately, when you Google or word search either the governor's daughter-in-law or me or Patrick Millsap, all of this comes up because it was contained in an allegation and there has to be a boundary. There has to be a line. So this isn't about Nathan Deal. This isn't about the process. This is about what happens when somebody crosses the line and whether or not there's some consequences. So what is it we want? Well, we want a line. This isn't about money. Neither the governor nor anyone else is seeking to recover the tens of thousands of dollars that was associated with an extensive examination of every aspect of his campaign, literally the equivalent of a tax audit of every line of every report he ever filed. That's not what's sought. We're not even seeking the recovery of the fees associated with the filings. And there were six filings where the same allegations were repeated over and over again, and they were repeated even as of yesterday. What we seek are just two things: an apology and 1/2 hour of my time. That's it. This isn't about money. This is not about recovering or being made whole. Certainly under the rules it would have been contemplated, but it wasn't. This is about you sending a very clear signal to say there is a boundary and we will impose and make that boundary felt if you cross the line. And it strikes me that it's pretty interesting that you have yet to hear one person defend the content of what was said. And if it was said about any one of you or anybody else, you would have the same outrage that we have about somebody who shows so little regard for where the boundaries are. And in the end of the day, that's what this is about. It's about establishing that there is a line, that when you drag people who aren't candidates through the mud and make false, groundless, egregious, malicious, libelous allegations against them, there will be a level of accountability. And like the state bar, and like federal courts, and like others, you'll answer the responsibility to draw that line and impose that consequence.
Thank you, Mr. Evans. Mr. Anderson.
You've got 10 minutes. Yes, sir.
I have for something like 17 years tried to make a difference and tried to help citizens around the state and probably 70, 80 counties by now. I have tried to assist them with educating them with ethics seminars. I have been told many times by Holly Manhauer, First Amendment Foundation, that I was her ambassador to get the open records books out to the public, and she would send me as many as she could, and I would make up more off the computer. I have struggled and struggled and struggled to come up with just exhibits and responses for this motion for attorney's fees. As far as what Mr. Evans said a moment ago, as far as allegations that he said border in the area of libelous or areas that were unfounded and so forth, I want to say to Governor Nathan Deal and to Mr. Evans and McKenna Long that in some of the language I used in the complaints, I sincerely apologize. I also want to say that before the complaints put in the hands of Executive Secretary Holly Burge, Sherilyn Stricter, Stacey Kelberman, we're going full tilt with the FBI and with the U.S. Attorney's Office on all three complaints. So they have been administratively dismissed by the commission staff, all three, by the executive secretary, one in February, one on July 20, two on July 23rd. All three complaints are not frivolous in any nature whatsoever. If you look at any definition of frivolous, they have merit. They had from previous commissions and previous staff, previous executive secretaries. They were approved to go forward. They were not defective. They went under investigation. And to come back after you terminate the executive secretary and the main investigator, Sherilyn Stricter, who had told me, Stacy and Sherilyn had told me, that these were the main complaints going before the U.S. Attorney's Office before he was offered the judgeship by Governor Nathan Deal. Now, under OCGA 9-1415C, no attorney or party shall be excess attorney's fees as to any claim or defense which the court determines was assessed by said attorney or party in a good faith on some recognized precedential or persuasive authority. The state bar. Now, this should be in the rebuttal, but I am so upset to hear that when he sent off 31 pages the night, one day before the commission hearing this morning, with an exhibit A on the state bar from 2007, he states that that is an example of what they've had to put up with. The state bar found no grounds and found that it was a baseless lawsuit by the state bar, and the agreement set forth said that Mr. Anderson has not agreed that he has done anything, nor do we find that he has done anything that exhibits acting as an attorney in any improper form, and also the agreement states that he will not do so in the future. It was signed by me, by my attorney, Emmett Bondurant, and it was done with John Marty of the State Bar, and it never said that I was guilty of any State Bar violations. Let's make that clear. Sherman, we are now, and I'm concerned as a citizen of the state of Georgia and as a citizen of the United States, because it really bothers me. I'm concerned for ethical behavior, honor, and integrity, and the things that I preach in ethics seminars of moral character, that everyone, elected officials, appointees, employees should have a conscience. It's even in the Georgia Constitution about your conscience, not in the federal. But we are 50th now, Chairman. 50th out of 50 states is the most corrupt state in the Union. 50th. And this just came out a couple months ago. Now, I'm not an attorney, and I have never, ever put myself out to be one. I am a concerned citizen. I've been called all kinds of things. I've been called ethics gadfly, watchdog, some names I heard was said by Governor Perdue that I will not repeat here. But when a man assumes a public trust, he should consider himself public property. Spoken, well spoken by Thomas Jefferson. You cannot trust a man to control others who cannot control himself. A very good quote by Robert E. Lee. Now, the motion to dismiss an award of fees is a frivolous action by Governor Deal. Each complaint, whether it had libelous or words in it and sentences, that is freedom of speech, but I apologize to the governor today and I apologize to Mr. Evans because my language was too strong and I sincerely apologize. But I do get to the point that affects my health and I start getting all messed up in one way or the other. I have provided this commission today, Exhibit A, very, very personal information, very personal, that I got from my doctor. But I was not able to attend those hearings. Now, Mr. Evans says, well, now we're not going to even go there. But what I'm saying to you is that I would have been here and I would have stated my case concerning all three complaints as I have in the past on preliminary hearings. Let me also say that you have a case, Atlanta Humane Society and Bill Garrett appellates versus Barbara L. Harkins, dealing with OCGA 9-11-11.1, dealing with an anti-SLAPP statute and dealing with a successful one, because the intent here today, Chairman, the whole gist of this today is a citizen. I'm not, you know, I tried as a member of the Office of Consumer Affairs, but as soon as I complained to the governor that he wasn't holding meetings for a year and a half, he got me off real quick, rather than make it work. Just like y'all been taking, your funds taken from y'all, I guess funds were taken from there. But why should we even meet if we're going to be toothless? The Common Cause Georgia has put down that this is now defamed. This is toothless. This is, this commission has lost 41% of its budget. 31 employees is down to 11. I'm concerned about that. I'm concerned about officials that violate the public's trust. But when I take it to the Attorney General, when I take it to the Inspector General, when I take it to other offices, nothing happens. Over the years, since the 90s, 2000s, and today, 2012, I have always found the commission that was formerly and proudly the State Ethics Commission. 40 other states continue to have ethics in their title. 40. I looked. I researched. The bottom line, Chairman, is I want the governor and I want all elected officials that I have tried to hold accountable for almost 20 years to the detriment of my financial status, to the detriment of my health, I want them to do what they're supposed to do under OCGA 4510.1. They're supposed to serve the public and not betray the public's trust. And Chairman, that has not happened. And if I made allegations that I did not substantiate, Many a time on this complaint here, I read on one of the complaints, it had 14 allegations. The commission under Sherilyn Stricter, investigator and attorney, and Stacey Kelberman found, I believe it was another 30 or something odd violations on my complaint. That's what I was used to for years and years and years. Once you bring it for the commission, you're like a district attorney. A district attorney files his case. If he loses, he is not charged and filed against for legal fees. He has filed a case dutifully with the evidence he had. I did the same as a citizen. I, with limited financial means, and citizens across this state, are so chill that I shared with Mr. Evans earlier before lunch, I'll never file an ethics complaint again and try to take care of my health and my family and so forth, because this commission has changed. If you're going to be honorable, if you're going to have integrity, you need to tell the state legislature this is wrong, especially when you have House Bill 1473 sponsored by David Ralston, who goes on a junket for what, 15,000, 20,000 by lobbyists that you just handled recently? Think about it. We have our lawmakers, lawbreakers, and it's a shame, because I would like to look up to them to serve the people and not serve special interests. And that's what George Anderson has been about for almost 20 years. And to come here today and say that I have tried to disparage McKenna Long, I apologize, sir, I sincerely apologize. And disparage the governor of the state of Georgia. But I have documents here that even is on under the Office of Congressional Ethics, sir. Under the Office of Congressional Ethics and crew, Attorney Evans was representing him, and he resigned under fire so he could run for governor. And unfortunately, the people of Georgia thought they were getting a governor that was going to serve the public's trust. I hope sincerely he does. But there are questions that need to be answered. Subpoenas were turned down by Patrick Millsaps, and they should have been given to Stacey Kelberman. Subpoenas have been done in the past. I think it was on the Oxidine complaint and the state mutual complaint. But sir, it frustrates me, because I care about my community, I care about the people in this state, and I've tried to help them as much as I possibly could. Telling them always, I'm not an attorney, but I'll try to see what I can do within the law.
Thank you, Mr. Anderson.
Thank you for the additional time.
Yes, sir. Mr. Evans, your rebuttal.
Thank you. First of all, on my own behalf and on behalf of the governor, we accept Mr. Anderson's apology. Unfortunately, I don't think he still gets it. I don't think he understands that there's a boundary. And whether you're a gadfly or whether you're an individual citizen, there are some things that you can't do, some things that you can't say without consequence. And outside of this process, those things would be libel, slander, and defamation. But within this process, it is within the purview of the commission, operating under its statutory authority, to provide redress. And no matter how many apologies we accepted, it won't change the Google internet searches, the repetition by the media of things that are completely untrue. And you didn't hear, Mr. Chair, none of you heard one fact that would provide one scintilla of evidence why Denise Deal was accused of some of the most unbelievable illegal conduct you could imagine. And that's because it doesn't exist, it's contradicted by the filing, and yet, unless you take action, it will always remain there. The same is true with regard to my firm and the allegation of kickbacks and the allegation of conspiracies. I have to say, in all degree of candor, I can't accept the idea that any of this happens in good faith, because I know that with me, that if a judge told me, Mr. Evans, that I'm rejecting that argument, that's unfounded, I wouldn't go around repeating it. I wouldn't make it in the next motion. I wouldn't make it in the next complaint. I wouldn't repeat it over and over again, because I know that whether it's Judge Vinings or Judge Arenda Evans or any of them, what the consequence would be. And yet you just heard a diatribe literally repeating some of the most false and groundless accusations that have been rejected by this commission repeatedly and with impunity, almost in open defiance. At the end of the day, you have to decide, is there a line? Nobody doubts that that line has been crossed. And the only action left is for you to decide what is the consequence when someone so consciously disregards the boundaries that have been imposed by the statute and which really should apply to anyone who acts in the name of trying to promote good government. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Evans. Questions, comments? Oh, Mr. Anderson, did you want to
rebuttal, sir?
Yes, sir.
Chairman, I don't know personally Governor Nathan Dale. I, until today, have just met Mr. Evans. But in the language that I used in some of the complaints, it was strong, and I apologize that it was worded the way it was. People that know me have come to know that I can be at times upset and passionate about stories I see and actions that are occurring, and I wonder why something's not being done to look into it. The frustration I've seen so many times when a newspaper or some article comes out, and then either McKenna Long or some other law firm, whether it's Doug Chalmers, another attorney before you over the years, or whether it's Robert Highsmith, another attorney, and in the Purdue administration, I have met many attorneys over the years that wanted me to shut up and go away. Call me all kind of names, whether it be gadfly or whether it be a nicer word or a lesser word. This 10-page opinion by Dennis Dunn, Senior Assistant Attorney General, dealing with the appointment of Patrick Millsap was right on. I brought that to the attention of the commission. Jonathan Hawke's opinion that was requested by the commission, I read it and read it and read it, and it says to take it on a case-by-case basis. I listened to him today. I've got copies of his. I was fortunate to find it on the internet because the commission has not furnished me, nor McKenna Long, all these documents that go back and forth between the governor's law firm and the commission. Previous staffs and previous commissions have always made certain I had copies of everything. Elizabeth Ott didn't get it. Kimberly Carter didn't get it. I get it. I get that things have changed and it's now more politically influenced. But I ask you today, in objectivity, with integrity, and with the foresight to see that you are in a way being manipulated. And I hope, because you were appointed by the governor, by the House Speaker, by the Senate committee, that you will look at the entire picture, the picture that administrative dismissals do not mean a frivolous complaint. Administrative dismissals are in the situation under State Charles Walker by Teddy Lee, former executive secretary. He stood before the members of the commission and he said back 10 years ago, Mr. Anderson is totally correct on all of his allegations and what he has found dealing with State Senator Charles Walker. However, since or now, after he's come out with it for months and we've got it set for hearing, there are now 172 counts against him by the U.S. Attorney's Office. I recommend the commission vote to allow the feds handle this, and we will dismiss Mr. Anderson's complaint, but thank you for bringing it to our attention. Complaints can be dismissed administratively. They can be dismissed by the commission, but that doesn't mean they are without merit. I had several things in there regarding attorney fees that ended up in an opinion by Jonathan Hawks that they are something we need to look at.
Thank you.
Involving senatorial fees.
Thank you. We've covered that ground. Thank you.
Well, now, sir, Chairman, you might say that you covered that ground, but an opinion by the chairman or the commission is just what you say you've covered. I heard that before. We've covered that. That's what the executive secretary said in the dismissal. That doesn't mean the complaint 0008, 0009, or 0011.
Mr. Anderson, I'm asking you to conclude at this point.
Do I have a moment to conclude?
You have about 30 seconds.
In my 30 seconds, Chairman, I'd like to say that I appreciate the time that you have given me today. I appreciate that you have not acted in any manner that was disrespectful towards me. You have been very patient, and I appreciate it. The reason I've gotten emotional here is because this is not a time for me or any citizen to be faced with elected officials, as McKenna Long knows. Kent, 5 seconds. Thank you. I have 5 seconds. The biggest point I wanted to make to this commission today, Chairman, is no citizen in this state can afford attorney's fees.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Candidates can use campaign funds to pay for legal fees.
Mr. Anderson, that's
we
it.
We don't have that opportunity.
We got it.
You understand it.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Questions, comments from the commission?
First of all, thank you both for the passionate presentation. Which we appreciate. Mr. Abernethy, again,
they're in conversation.
Okay. Probably a couple of questions.
Sure, absolutely.
So you're here representing the Governor Deal.
The respondent, yes.
Right. And as far as the respondents, you're not bringing the motion.
That's correct.
I just want to be clear on the standard.
Yeah, the respondent. The respondent is bringing the motion and is permitted. He is limiting the motion to 3 claims that were all found to be without factual or legal merit. They involve people other than himself.
So there's no issue of standing here?
No, there's no issue of standing because he, in fact, incurred the fees that were required to defend all 3.
Well, this is really for both of you, but as I've looked at this, we've got this standard. It's a may, not a must standard on those attorney's fees. The question is whether we think this is frivolous. If we find it's frivolous, then we could impose it or not. I'm sensitive to what the standard is. I'm also sensitive to the ability of citizens to step forward. And I am sensitive to showing it that. For you, Mr. Evans, I very much respect the fact that you're sticking up for people who've been singled out. Any of us who've been in public service know that feeling. I would suggest just a couple of things. One is avoid filing things at the last minute that clearly take a lot more than the last minute to repair. But from the commission standpoint, it backlines. We get up to an email before, it's 20 pages, 30 pages. It doesn't really assist us. And the other thing I just suggest, and that is, if you make such compelling presentations, but I would avoid with the commission at least making statements as facts when they are assertions. So, for instance, I may be incorrect here, but I think the dismissal of the claim, which I was happy to hear about, you guys dismissed, therefore it was clearly frivolous. I don't know that that's why Mr. Anderson dismissed it. I think he just dismissed it, which I was happy about. Maybe he dismissed it and he claimed it was frivolous, but in your comments he said he dismissed it, therefore it's frivolous. In stating that everybody agrees to things that have been libel, it's slanderous, and everything he said. I think that's an assertion, and there may be libel and slander mixed in there, but I would just avoid overstating. That said, getting back to my first point, I really respect the presentation you made, which has been very good, and I'm, as I said, anybody in public life is very sensitive to that. And Mr. Anderson,
Well, may I just address a couple of those things?
Sure. Well, let me speak to both of you.
That's fine. Absolutely. First of all, I don't agree with you that the statute is the statute says shall impose, shall award, actually is the phrase. I think the only discretion is the determination of whether it's frivolous. So I don't agree with you. I think that's a. I think that actually issue was in fact addressed in the committee meetings for the proposal of the statute. The question was, would it be discretionary or not? The decision was that it would be mandatory. So I think I don't agree with you there. I think second, I think the very fact that Mr. Anderson apologizes for the statements would indicate that it's not an assertion that they were founded or unfrivolous, but the very fact is that I think we have an acknowledgement which was corroborated by independent third parties. And the third is, I disagree with you about what the impact of the dismissals that the staff recommended to the commission, which you accepted. As to the three that we selected, in fact, it was determined that they were without factual or legal merit, and as a result, didn't even merit a probable cause hearing. So I think on all three accounts, I completely disagree with you. I don't think any of the three are accurate.
No, I think you're correct on the shall. And I was at the beginning of the statute, so I was correct on that. But it may and not must in the frivolous, so I stand correct on that, and thank you. On the other points, they didn't address all the points I made, but I appreciate it.
Well, I think the administrative dismissal was a recommendation by the staff that it lacked no legal or factual basis, and as a result, it didn't merit a probable cause hearing. That was a substantive determination, so I disagree with you on that. But I say that because my expectation is down the road we're going to have to revisit this, and I want this record to be as nice and clean and accurate as possible. And as a result, I think it is important that those fine points, in fact, be refined to the point of precise accuracy.
Yeah. Well, and I appreciate that. And I don't know at the end of the day, whoever line what everyone here thinks you're going to finding frivolous. There are certainly problems with a lot of it, but I can assure you I wouldn't have spent the time I spent and more that the chair mentioned if I thought it was frivolous, everything was frivolous. That said, I think there were a lot of problems. But let me turn.
Well, but remember, we only filed as to three for which you spent no time. You spent three which the staff spent an enormous amount of time. Mm-hmm. And the very essence of this motion is to say, at some point, this staff gets overstretched, overburdened, and the fact of the matter is that when it came to you, in fact, all that had happened was everybody had agreed, including now today Mr. Anderson, and including Common Cause, agreed that they were without basis. And so that's it. I should have mentioned the other issue, which is, why is it we filed on Wednesday night for today? And the reason was because we were getting a new filing every day. And the conclusion was that we could have either done one of two things. We could have either filed every time we got a response, or we just waited until we figured we'd gotten the last one, and then given you a comprehensive response. But I am fine. If your preference is to get a new sheet of paper every time the complainant files a new sheet of paper, yeah. We'd be more than willing to do that.
Yes, I've got this, Mr. Stringfield.
Vice Chair Stringfield.
Yeah, I'm sorry to interrupt. I just know. Are you entertaining all three of these at one time, or do you want to move along? I know that I'm not going to be able to stay on the phone much past 2 o'clock.
We're taking all three at the same time. So we're about to wrap up the portion of argument. I can't imagine it'll take much longer than 10 more minutes.
Thank you. Mr. Anderson, let me just stress a few things to you and then respond, and then I think we'll just all probably make whatever comments we want to make
Just a rebuttal on his saying that that I stood up here and said that they were baseless. All three complaints were right on, and they were stated.
Now we appreciate completely that your opinion and his are right.
I never said they were baseless.
So. Right. No, I know I appreciate that. And so, for you, Mr. Anderson, I just want to say first, I do appreciate, and I think we all appreciate any citizens.
Do I have a chance to rebuttal?
Sure. Just to answer. I think all of us appreciate any citizen stepping forward and making claims. That's a citizen's right, and that's one of the reasons we're here. And we appreciate your doing that. And I don't question your motivations. But I would say that you've addressed why you weren't here and you didn't show up before, which I appreciate because I was wondering why we were receiving all of this massive amount of information and then not seeing you. So I understand that and I appreciate the explanation and hope you're well. But I also want to say that be it for this hearing or particularly later on, when you make claims, they should be serious claims with support. And what we've received a lot of times, there's some parts that are serious, Some, frankly, don't seem serious, and the staff spends a huge amount of time, and we as commissioners spend a huge amount of time trying to make any sense, frankly, of what a lot of what's said. And it's not really furthering the cause of justice to do that. And in the future, as we take complaints from not just you, Mr. Anderson, but anybody, we're really going to have to start looking at how they're framed and if there's support for them, because if there's not, we can't go forward. That said, as I mentioned earlier, we did spend quite a bit of time on what you filed, and I'm not saying everything was frivolous by any stretch, but you got to be careful with your words, how you fashion things, the support you have.
I agree.
And to call McKenna Long Aldridge names, the governor names, or this commission of volunteers, kangaroo court, that doesn't really further your cause. So I would just be very much more selective in what you do in the future.
I apologize. I should have not stated any of that. I was very, very concerned that the commission has really changed. Maybe it's due to lack of funding. You know, we had Ardella Bass and Sonny Adams for years taking care of everything in the elections office, and then the state of Georgia and all its wisdom put all this on you and your staff, and take you from a larger staff with funding, then you had to terminate all these employees. And it hasn't been right, and I have felt for y'all. But Chairman, I want to say to you, I want to say it from the bottom of my heart, I have come before this commission, I have filed complaints, I have done it for a long period of time, and as I stated to Mr. Evans a little while ago, Mr. Vincent, you won't ever see me again, because this has just taken too much of a health toll, financial toll, to try to get these exhibits paid for. And I was told I'd have to have 12 of them. It turns out some of them for news media, so they're out there to the news media. But the bottom line, Chairman, is I have tried with very limited resources to keep officials accountable, and this commission needs to spend time with the General Assembly, as it was spoken earlier, and maybe say, hey, you know, yeah, y'all been successful. I mean, I don't see any of y'all saying this, but you're going to have probably Mr. Evans and some of his law firm, you know, in jubilation. But I think you should say to them that to put this on complainants, when they have no campaign funds, they have no financial remedy, and to slap them with some kind of large, large fine, that's not right.
Yeah, well, thanks. I'm going to leave it to other commissioners' comment. I think we've probably heard.
But you've seen the last of me, because
well,
I don't think it can be changed when everything goes the way it goes.
Thank you, Mr. Anderson.
Can I ask a question, Mr. Anderson?
Sure.
Mr. Anderson, do you believe that there is such a thing as a frivolous complaint?
I believe that if you look up as I did and you see all the reasons for a frivolous complaint, which I put into the documents that I tendered to the commission and in the exhibits.
I'm not asking if you think yours are a frivolous complaint. I'm asking
House Bill 1473 put in the word frivolous. All three of those complaints were not frivolous. They were had merit.
I'm not asking the question on your particular ones, but
yes, sir.
Do you believe that it is possible for a citizen of the state of Georgia to file a complaint that is wholly frivolous?
Yes, sir. And that's why I've received, and you can check with the ethics staff. Excuse me, I'm used to it being an ethics commission and an ethics staff. You can check with the campaign finance commission staff, and you will find through Teddy Lee, Rick Thompson, Stacy Kelberman, and Holly LaBerge, especially very quickly on that last complaint on Governor Dale, you will find that I received several, probably approaching 100 or more complaints tendered back to me stating that I needed to either cite this code better or cite this fact better, and that I either threw it in the trash and said, I'm just going to give up, or I tried to fix it correctly and refile it, and it was accepted. I agree with you, sir, 100%. And that's why we have it in the law and in the rules and regulations of the commission to take a defective complaint and send it back. and tell them that either they correct it or it will not be accepted by the commission. But to take three complaints that have been investigated and they have been discussed with FBI agents and before Governor Beal appointed the U.S. attorney under the investigation, a judge.
Right. Mr. Anderson, well, thank you, and we appreciate your comments.
I do agree with you, sir, on frivolous complaints.
Commissioner Alexander, I believe, has one more remark.
One more comment, and then Mr. Stringfellow has anything to say, and people will probably be ready. But I hope for the benefit of the public, and you as well, Mr. Anderson, that nobody's rights chilled here. I think anybody who wants to file something in front of this commission should. That shouldn't be the outcome of this at all. But that said, we've got to take this matter under advisement and I think make a decision tonight. So if anyone has a motion or Mr. Stringfellow.
Hillary, any remarks from you? We may have lost her. Okay. Commissioner Garrett, we'll give one comment.
Again, this is a difficult situation. The legislature has this in the statute for a reason. I personally believe that just like in the federal courts and the state courts, in these quasi-judicial executive agencies like this, we have to be both guardians of the policy to invite citizen participation, but we also have to be guardians of the fact that there are lawyers and citizens who will abuse and take advantage of the process. And I'm a big believer in the concept and principle of not guilty until proven otherwise. And it is a modern reality that individuals, whether well-intentioned or not, at the beginning can abuse a process like this. And in the court of public opinion, in particular in these hyper-partisan environment we live in today, we've got to have a mechanism to guard against frivolous, both legally and factually, these statements. I think one of the things that happens for the commission that I've observed over the years is it demeans the process and it makes it more difficult for either the public or for the commissioners to deal effectively with the serious allegations that are brought and that I heard these people address. So I think that we should be very cautious in applying this, but at the same point in time, I think that the legislature rightfully saw a need because of the abuse that I believe had been the historical precedent of certain individuals and groups before the commission over time. It shouldn't act as a chilling if we handle that correctly and we only apply this in unusual circumstances. But I do think there's a role for that.
Okay. Additional comments?
60 seconds.
I'm sorry.
30 seconds.
Yeah, you had your moment. I'm going to make some general comments. I appreciate Mr. Anderson being here today in person. Mr. Evans is always insightful and has good things for us to think about as well. Let me just leave with a big picture observation that I want to impress on everybody here today who's been following this. To the extent that there is anybody who doesn't understand or realize the amount of work that went in to adjudicating, investigating, reading, and analyzing everything that was connected to the Governor Deal investigations. Let me put that to rest today. Whether it is the current commission, a former commission, a current director, a former director, everybody has worked very hard on this matter. And I think the result speaks for itself, which is the governor ended up paying an administrative fine of over $3,000. So with that said, this has been a difficult and a long investigation. And today, hopefully, it will be coming to an end at long last. I did hear Mr. Anderson apologize a number of times, and I certainly appreciate that. Given his comments, and some of the filings he's made, I think he understands the seriousness of the code section and the mechanism that there is to trigger the assessment of fees for frivolous complaints. And there's no question it's there, and the legislature duly passed it, and we're deemed
with the authority to enforce it. With that said, I'm going to move to dismiss all the motions for attorney's fees that are currently pending. Is that motion seconded?
Second.
Okay, Commissioner Alexander seconds. All those in favor, please signal by saying aye. Aye.
Aye.
I'm opposed.
Okay, so the motion's going to carry 2-1, and the motion for fees is dismissed.
No, wait, I'm sorry. Hold on. If we can.
I think Hillary had to.
Yeah, she's on.
Hillary.
Oh, Hillary.
Well, if you would repeat that. And then
we just took a vote.
Maybe since she's on and dropped off.
George. Okay, Hillary, can you hear us all right now? Okay.
George.
Procedurally, I thought Commissioner Stringfellow was on the line. She was not on the line. She was cut off. So I'm going to remove to dismiss the pending motions for attorney's fees pending against George Anderson, and I ask for the motion to be seconded.
And I second.
Okay, Commissioner Alexander seconds. All those in favor, please signal by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, and Commissioner Garrett is no. Okay, so the motion carries 3-1, and Mr. Anderson, the motion for fees pending against you has been dismissed. The next item.
Mr. Chairman, I'd just like to, this is a comment, but I opposed, however, had the motion not carried, I would have supported a finding of frivolousness in a couple of the items, not all three. I would have made a motion in regards to that. We made a motion that we reduce the amount asked for in order to make the point that I do believe factually any definition of frivolous, several of these complaints were clearly within Black's Law Dictionary for frivolous and fit a pattern of frivolousness that even some of Mr. Anderson's supporters here today acknowledged indirectly, if not directly. I would not have wanted to send a message without us establishing a clearer understanding of what we're going to define frivolousness as in the future. I know this begins that process. But I think we need to, I think we should, I would prefer that we were sending a little bit of a message to folks that they need to perfect their claims properly, even if they're average citizens, but more importantly, not engage in a pattern of using the privilege of filing these things in front of the Ethics Commission. And hopefully the actions and the words by both Mr. Anderson and Mr. Evans today are sincere, and we'll move forward from this.
Can I say something?
Right, sure.
I just wanted to address something that I think Mr. Perry had said earlier about being worried about chilling people's First Amendment rights. And I'm a staff attorney, and I do review most of the complaints that come in. And I have made a real effort to only accept those claims which I feel clearly state what the allegations are, and there has to be evidence. However, that being said, I do take the time to let the complainant know why this is being rejected, and I give them every opportunity to fix the issues and resubmit, and I encourage them to do so. And I've actually done that for Mr. Anderson as well. So we do take the time, we take it very seriously, and we want to encourage the public. So I just want to make it very clear to everyone that we go out of our way to try to, on the one hand, make sure that the complaints are legitimate, but on the other hand, to give the complainant every opportunity to fix any issue that has caused their complaint to be denied.
Thank you. That's an important comment.
Chairman, I just want to say I agree.
No, Mr. Anderson, please sit down. Vice Chairman Stringfellow, please go ahead. Okay, thank you. We're gonna lose Chairman Stringfellow. Okay, thank you for the comments by all. The next item on the agenda is our report from the Executive Director.
Keep it brief. We've had some regional trainings around the state that we did this year, this fiscal year, in an attempt to get out beyond the metro area. We held one in Dalton, we had 6 people show up. We had one in Augusta, we had 24. And we have one in Warner Robins, there were 25. These are not being very well attended, even though we have advertised these to everybody that we know possibly to send this to. We have one coming up in March in Albany and another one in April in Brunswick, and that will wrap up our 5-city tour. Last year we had a little over 1,000 people attend our classes, just so you have an idea of what we're doing in the realm of training. Wanted to speak briefly on something new that we started doing with MailChimp. It's a company that we are using to send out our purchase reminders. We are now sending them not just 30 days and 15 days before, but we're sending them the day before the filing period opens and the day before the grace period ends. This is not free. I think this cost us $300 last month for all the ones that we sent out. But, for instance, we sent out to all the lobbyists the notice on this agenda item. We've also sent out a notice to over 12,000 people that our website is going to be down from December 21st to December 26th. And we picked that date because our never reports due, and the staff will be gone for the Christmas holidays. And what we are doing is we will be migrating to virtual servers. And what this is going to do is it's going to eliminate the issue with the capacity problem with people filing. So it is now going to be a moot point that people couldn't get into the system or timed out, and it's not going to be the system's fault anymore.
Folks
on notice with that the capacity issue will be taken care of. I have our IT director here. He's going to speak briefly to that if you want to just give a little bit of information on that. This is Joel Perkins. He is our IT director. He is on contract with us. And we also have a programmer that is on contract with us. And these two have done an amazing job in attempting to rectify the, it's just the mess we inherited. There's no other way to put it.
Joel, welcome. Yeah, thank you for being here today.
Joel Perkins, as Holly said, hired as come in as a IT director / system network administrator. We're really addressing two areas. We've got the internal infrastructure and the public-facing infrastructure. What she's speaking to is the public-facing infrastructure. We're moving to Rackspace, which is a tier one service provider. Holly had the technical foresight to see that that's the problem and address that by going to Rackspace, where we are increasing our server capacity. We are load balancing traffic. And we're going to be able to eliminate the capacity problem that the current infrastructure is experiencing.
Great.
Any questions about that?
Sounds like you've got a lot of work to do, but you are off to a good start, so thank you. I know it's not an easy task.
No, and there's a lot of opportunity that we can address other areas as we make this move and improve the internal infrastructure.
Okay. Great. Well, again, thanks for being here today. Thanks for what you're doing.
There are budget numbers in the book. I was able to get October's expenditures, so I think Lisa gave you the updated form. But what's in the book is how we finished out fiscal year 12. We didn't get a chance to do that at the July meeting, and how we're looking for 13. I will tell you that FY 13. There are two sets of numbers in there. The one is the appropriation. The other one is the holdback, the 3% holdback that we had to submit. So that's one of the things that I will be working with the budget office, is to try to get them to not take that holdback. They didn't take it last year. I'm hoping I'm successful again this year. Let's see. There's also information in there in regards to our revenue collections. And our retained revenue, and stop me at any time if anybody has questions. I just know it's late and everybody's ready to get out of here. Our budget submission for FY14, we were not allowed to submit requests. We just had to submit the holdback. So I will be working with the budget offices, the one-time $100,000 funds that we got for IT upgrades. I'm asking for about $59,000 of that change to be rolled into permanent funding to handle the Rackspace contract. We used roughly $60,000 for the Rackspace contract for our virtual servers, and the other $40,000 for this programmer that is helping us get some issues with our code situated. There is some outstanding civil penalties that this agency has never been able to collect from cases that were adjudicated. We have gone round and round and round trying to figure out how to collect these, and we are in the process of working with DOAS to piggyback onto Department of Revenue's collection agencies that they use. In order to get them to, it's not, we don't have enough account or dollar figure for a collection agency to help us. But if we can piggyback on revenue, who has thousands of accounts and millions of dollars are trying to collect, that's more feasible. So we're, that's in the works. Nothing is set yet. We're still in the planning process of that, trying to get that up and going. We do have a clerical position that we are hiring. I think we're doing interviews the week after Thanksgiving. And this position will be in our education department that will help with data entry, responding to phone calls, emails, that stuff. We have four folks back there right now that work incredibly hard, but we need more. This is one position that we were able to pick up in last year's budget. So we are hiring for that. I've talked about the website being down. That notice went out to 12,000 folks. It's pretty much everybody who's ever had an email address with us. We've let them know. It's on our website. It's posted in our office. It's on that agenda. We're handing it out to every person that walks in. We don't foresee this being a problem because it's being over the holiday and there are no reports due at that time. And this will allow us to be migrated over, ready for the December 31st filing. And everybody has to file December 31st. All lobbyists, all candidates, and all elected officials. So that's what we're working on with that. And the other thing we've instituted, just briefly as far as a staffing issue, is we've instituted blackout dates. Blackout dates seem to be fairly prevalent in the private industry, but we have days blacked out around filing periods where staff are not allowed to take days off, so that we have the office as staffed as we possibly can around the filing period, because that's when we have the highest volume of phone calls and emails. Now, obviously, we had two staff members that were out for some medical reasons, which cannot be avoided. But we have done that, and we have seen huge improvement in being able to respond to our filers.
Great. Well, Holly, you continue to do a great job, and particularly on the budget. I know that's challenging, to say the least, but we are actually an agency that has received an increase in appropriation despite some extremely difficult financial, fiscal, economic issues, and it's much appreciated and noticed. So thank you for all you're doing.
Thank you.
Thank you for the report. Questions? Yeah. I think the last item on the agenda is public comment. So, Mr. Perry.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I did just want to take 30 seconds because I share Mr. Evans' concern to make the record crystal clear. And Mr. Evans did state that I and Common Cause said that the complaints being considered were malicious, libelous, and that is not what I said. So I wanted to be crystal clear that I think that the complaints did have some merit, but language used in the complaint were malicious and possibly libelous. And I just kind of wanted to give a for instance, since it was discovered about those the complaints, the one involving the governor's daughter-in-law, for instance, was about a payment that took an investigative reporter with 30 years of experience to uncover, and it brought about the questions that we said at the time and still say were very legitimate, that we do feel those kind of questions need to be asked, especially when the chairman of the campaign said the intent was to do it in such a way that wouldn't appear inappropriate. So there are some serious questions that come out of that that arise. So I just wanted to make sure that it wasn't confused, that there was no, that we thought the complaint lacked merit, but that it was not, in fact, my intention to get up and say that the complaints were, that the language that was used within that was definitely something that was not appropriate.
Thank you. Additional comment, Mr. Evans.
And not to respond, I'm actually
This is the gift that keeps giving, isn't it?
Well, it's an important issue.
I know it is, and I'm not making light of it.
And the reason I rise actually is, first of all, I want to express my appreciation to everybody's long and hard work on it. I think it's a critical moment, and I rise because I suspect in the future we will revisit this topic. I think the commission today has basically declared open season on candidates and their families and their vendors. There's really effectively no boundary for the kinds of to use Mr. Perry's words, libelous and malicious allegations or statements that can be made. There's no line that gets drawn. And the net result is when you open the floodgates, we can expect to revisit this more and more again. I suspect that all of my colleagues and friends who serve in various constitutional offices in the legislature and other places will take note that, in fact, even when you have admitted, and I recognize Commissioner Alexander will probably think that's an exaggeration, notwithstanding the apology that we heard, admitted libelous, defamatory, and malicious statements, that there is no consequence. And when that happens, more often than not, you end up with more. And at the end of the day, we may have punted it down the road, but at some point, there will either be a line that gets drawn, or the executive secretary and the staff attorney will drown, because they'll just drown in having to deal with them. They have to deal with them day in and day out. They have to filter through them and get to the reality of the situation. And until then, unfortunately, I think candidates and their families and their friends and anybody who they deal business with will have to weather all of the news media repeating those as if they're the truth of the gospel. And the complainants get to make them with the impunity of knowing that at the end of the day, there is no consequence.
Thank you, Mr. Evans.
If it's any consolation, Mr. Evans, I Googled you and you have extraordinary accolades and honors.
So true. Unfortunately,
I don't mean to open it up.
If you Google me with kickback, if you giggle me with kickback,
no, I'm trying to make light of it. Actually, it's just, you know, really a compliment. No, and, so, you take it as such.
And I actually just think this is quite serious.
No,
I think that the allegations that were made are generous as libelous or defamatory, for which there is no consequence. And when that happens, you can only expect more.
It is serious, and I would just say, I think the commission has been quite clear that all filers are now duly on notice. This is a mechanism in the Campaign Finance Act that's very real, and I'm sure we will revisit it again. I'm quite certain there will be motions for fees in the future, unfortunately. Mr.
I was going to move to adjourn.
Mr. Anderson, D.D.
Chairman, I earlier wanted to state this, and Mr. Perry stated it very well. I want to reiterate one of the reasons I got passionately angry was to see on the news, as I've seen over the years, something that would really just tell me that things are not right in government.
Okay, I'm going to second the motion to adjourn.
Thank you.
This is public comment, sir.
Yeah, and I'm moving to adjourn. I'm moving to adjourn.
Chairman, I'm not going to be up here before. This is my last opportunity.
Mr. Anderson, stop.
We have been more patient with you than any other litigant.
Mr. Anderson, no. No.
That was illegal.
Motion to adjourn. Is there a second?
If you don't like it.
All in favor, please say unless I'm not. Okay.
Time
is
George.
2.
Hey, George.
Sure.
You could have behaved.
Thank you, Kevin. You and to your family as well, my friend. Bye-bye.